On top. That's the command. Do you want to attack?
Je vais faire ça. professional.
Okay, keep taking the ready? Yeah, yeah. Now the
Some sentences from Scripture. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." And the Apostle Paul wrote in one of his letters, "I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." We meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Grace and mercy be with you all. My name is the Reverend Jane Crooks. I'm part of the clergy team here in Kings Norton, and it's my privilege this afternoon to be conducting this service. Just in case you're wondering, the service is being videoed for the sole reason that Gillian, Phillip's mother, is not able to be with us this afternoon. And so the service is being videoed for her benefit. It's not the usual thing that one would do at a funeral service, but we're doing it for Gillian, who will be very much in our thoughts and here in presence, if not in body. We have gathered here today to remember before God Phillip Hanks, and to give thanks for his life. He was known to most of his friends and family simply as Phil, so I shall refer to him as such throughout the service, with apologies to Gillian, his mum, who I know would not approve. He was and always will be Philip to her. Every one of you here today, and it's a real tribute to the character that Phil was, that there are so many of you here today, but each one of you has come here with your own very personal memories of him, and each of you is the richer for having known him. Our service this afternoon offers an opportunity both to say thank you for memories shared, but also to acknowledge the sadness and sorrow for what has been lost. We are here too to say goodbye, to acknowledge that we shall not see Phil again on this earth, and to commend him into God's keeping. We've gathered together in this ancient church where for centuries people have come to celebrate and to mourn, and which bears witness to a God who cares for the people whom he created. And we, as such, we draw strength from one another and from God as we hear what he is saying to us through the words of this service. So as you sit, could I ask you to bow your heads as we pray and affirm God's presence here with us now. God of all consolation, your son Jesus Christ was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend. Look with compassion on your children in their loss. Give to troubled hearts the light of hope, and strengthen in us the gift of faith. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Some memories of Phil from both family and some of his family, and from myself from talking with some of them the other day. Well, Phil was born in 1965, the middle one of five children. From listening to his sisters Wendy and Sarah, I gathered the impression that they were a close family who enjoyed for the most part each other's company and for whom childhood was happy and good. They got up to the usual childhood pranks and games, including when they were small, sharing a large double bed. And Phil enjoyed, even at an early age, building and making things, and his Meccano and train sets were often in use and very much played with. The family moved to Kings Norton in 1977, but Phil continued to attend the George Dixon School, even though it meant leaving home at 7:30 in the morning and catching three buses. He admitted in later life to playing truant on more than one occasion with his brother Paul, although Sarah said they weren't very smart at it as they got on the same bus as their form teacher. Phil always liked listening to music. He spent many an evening sitting in his armchair, happily listening to his CDs. Over the years, his taste changed slightly from the Osmonds through the Bee Gees to the Police, Simply Red, Maxi Priest, Coldplay, and of course, UB40. He and Liz went to many UB40 concerts, including the very first one ever performed in Birmingham, and he was very proud of the fact that he and his brother Martin were featured for a brief moment in a UB40 video. It was not long after moving to Kings Norton that Phil met Liz. She was one of a whole host of children that lived nearby and with whom Phil and his brothers and sisters went around with. I was told about Saturday evenings spent watching Dallas with a packet of pick and mix and a bottle of pop purchased from money Phil earned by running errands on his racing bike for an elderly lady. If the pop wasn't finished, Phil marked the bottle with a black line to ensure that no one else drank any. Little did he know that Paul would sneak a drink and replace it with water. Maybe it was payback for all the chocolate that Phil ate from Easter eggs that belonged to Paul and the others. After leaving school, Phil went to Hall Green College, where his subject was woodwork, and from there he went to work in the box factory in the jewellery quarter. He moved on from there to a job working with Brother Paul at Birmingham Powder Coating, and finally found a job at Rover in the paint shop. When Rover closed, he was fortunate to get work at BMW, again working alongside Brother Paul. His friendship with Liz blossomed, and they were married in July 1986 at St. Paul's Church in Kings Norton, living at first in Northfield and Sturchley before settling in Kings Norton. Liz said of Phil that he was a wonderful husband and a true gentleman. He was the sort who always opened the door for ladies, was charming and polite, and somehow always managed to make you feel special. He was also very generous with his time and his money. Their family expanded with the addition of two sons, Daniel and Luke, and Daniel said Phil was a good father, taking interest in their hobbies and schooling. They would spend every Saturday together while Liz was at work, and in their younger days, cycling to the Lickies was a favourite pastime. Phil encouraged the boys to always give of their best and supported them in their activities, for instance, watching kung fu and motocross competitions, and they had great fun on family holidays. He was thrilled to be asked to be godfather to Wendy's grandson William in June last year and was looking forward to getting to know William more. Well, having spent the day with the boys, Saturday evenings would find Phil out with Brother Martin and other mates, enjoying a pint and watching the football on the screen. And if Manchester United were on, then he was happier still. It was about 7 years ago that Phil began to feel unwell, and after investigations was diagnosed with Marfan's syndrome, a genetic disorder affecting the body's connective tissue. He developed an aortic aneurysm, which, although life-threatening, was held at bay for several years with treatment. However, 2 years ago, he needed major surgery, and then again in January of this year. It was a great shock to everyone, including the hospital staff, that after his most recent operation, Phil suffered further complications, which resulted in his death 2 weeks ago. And I know that Daniel wants to say something about the way his dad coped with his illness in just a few moments. Well, it's impossible to sum up a person's life in such a short space of time. But these are just a few of the memories that Liz, Wendy, and Sarah shared with me the other day. As I said, you've each come with your own memories, and you will have between you many more, I know. But I'm going to invite some members of Phil's family to come now and offer a few words of their own. Wendy and Sarah, would you like to come first? And then we'll hear from Daniel and Luke and Martin, if you follow those. So, nice and steady. Don't go too fast.
Mm-hmm. You're fine. We thought of you, we'd love to die, but that is nothing new. We thought about you yesterday and the days before that too. We think of you in silence and often speak your name. All we have are memories and your picture in frame. Your memories is our keepsake, with which we will never part. God has you in his keeping. We have you in his heart, in our hearts. We lost a loved one with a heart of gold. How much we miss him can never be told. He shared our troubles, helped us along. If we follow his footsteps, we will never go wrong. What he suffered, he told but few. He did not deserve what he went through. Tired, weary, he made no fuss, but tried so hard to stay with us. We prayed for a miracle, all in vain, that God would make him well again. But God knows best, we had no part. It eased your pain, but broke our hearts. We cannot bring the old days back when we were all together. The family chain is broken now, but memories live forever.
Dad, you were taken from us far too soon. You are going to miss out on so much. Luke's 18th birthday and every milestone occasion that we have. But we also know that you will be there in spirit. Keep an eye on us like you always did. We will do our best to look after Mum for you and keep her safe until you are reunited in a better place. You fought so hard while you were in a hospital. We know that you were tired and you could no longer stay with us. We also regret that we never had a chance to say goodbye properly. We are both so proud to call you our dad. We love you now and forever. Daniel, Luke, and your ever-loving wife, Liz.
For anyone who doesn't know me, I'm Martin, I'm Phil's older brother. Thank you all for attending. He would have been overwhelmed with the amount of people here. But he would also would have said what all the fuss was about, because he was a very unassuming kind of person. There's a couple of thank yous from the family, and then we'll get on to more personal things. I'd like to thank everybody from Ferber's for all their hard work and support, especially Sue and Dave and the lads up the back, and Tracy. On a personal note, and this is purely from me, I'd like to mention Steph. Well, she's my wife. I mean, not just for the support over the last 3 weeks, but as for as long as I can remember, she's the strength behind our family. There's one person, as we've already been told, who can't make it today, and obviously that's Mum, and that's because of her own ill health. Phil's passing has put into context what Mum goes through every day, and has been doing that for the last how many years. Although not here in person, she's very much here in spirit. Of all of us as a family, this goes for everyone and friends as well, who all visited Phil in hospital. I think we should all be very proud of the time we spent with Phil at Phil's bedside. I believe he knew we were all there and were giving him the help and support that he needed, as he would have been the first to do for any other one of us if we was in that same situation. I've got many memories of Phil. Obviously, you've all got your own. We'll all have different ones. But here's just a few. As already been mentioned, as a teenager, he loved his music. And you've heard the list that was said earlier on. Out of all of them, probably the Bee Gees was the most surprising, but he absolutely loved them. And he took a lot of stick for that. Then obviously it became UB40 and so on. The memories of UB40, I remember as a family, all the concerts we went to. The first ones at the Odeon New Street, the NEC, the all-day ones at St Andrews, which I know a lot of the friends as well, they were there. And Finsbury Park, when me, Paul, Phil, and I think it was Joanne, yeah? And the thing I remember about that was when the Pogues came on, yeah? How we got out of that alive, I'll never know. Right. His main interest at the time, as I say, was his music, and his most treasured possession was his stereo. And woe betide anybody who ever went anywhere near it. I remember in Mum's lounge with his music on, pilot jacket on, Shetland wool jumper, with his patches on his elbows, he didn't give a monkey's, and his bag of sweets, which was mainly his candy shrimps, his banana sweets, his chews, his blackjacks and his fruit salads, which he loved. I also remember as a growing up in his early years, his love for his cars. The first one he had was his Mark II Cortina that somehow he managed to embed in the garages up at our mum's house, remember? That quickly got pushed into our mum's garage and I don't think it was ever seen again. Then the next one was his Mark II Escort, which he had resprayed, and he absolutely idolised that car. He had it resprayed at a place where Paul was doing his YTS scheme, I think, yeah? The funny thing with that, why I remember that so much, he asked me to drive it home for him when it was finished. And I nearly wrote it off coming down the Soho Road. The thing with that was, neither of us had a licence and neither of us had insurance at the time, but it didn't really matter. He absolutely idolised that car. As we got older, my memories tend to be more of Phil as a family man, with Liz, the lads, especially the holidays we all shared as a family, all of us. We had lots of good times. They were good times. Some of the funniest ones was we'd all jump in a minibus that we'd hired, yeah? Right. We'd all end up saying, never again, never again. But we did it many times afterwards. And the one memory I've got of when we was down there, down at Kinnock Sands, we were struggling with something to do the one of the days. And I just looked on the map and I said, oh, we'll go to Mullion. Remember Mullion? Bob will remember. And we were, after a bit of persuasion, as I say, we all jumped in the minibus, went down to Mullion, we pulled up, and there was absolutely nothing there. Do you remember? Not a shop in sight. Nothing at all. And obviously I got a lot of stick for that, off all of them. The two I remember laughing most, because he's got a funny laugh, is Bob. And also the thing that stands out with Phil, he's got a laugh all to himself. It's quite distinctive. And it could be quite sarcastic as well, but you'd always remember it. And that was the two people I remember that stick in my mind, Bob and Phil. And all I remembered him saying was, Mullion, Mullion, in a sarcastic laugh, and that was Phil. Another memory of the holidays, which for some reason sticks with me, and it probably does with everybody else, was Daniel and his potty. Everywhere we went, that potty was coming out all the time. Didn't matter where we was. At the end of the day, we'd been on the beach, we go to the shops, we look round, it was all of us, and then all of a sudden, three of them were missing. It was them pair and Daniel, there he was, side of the road with his potty. Just something that sticks in my mind. And I know everybody else thinks the same. Not such a happy memory, but I've got to mention it because it happened on the holidays. My last memory of the holidays together was in Tynmouth when, we was there and Mum was there. And it was the last day, we were coming home on the Friday evening. And for some reason we pulled up and Daniel wanted some marshmallow sweets. So we got out, he got his marshmallows, and somehow, I don't know how, he consequently started to choke. It was a pretty close thing, and all I remember was Phil coming running over, and he couldn't shift the marshmallows. I grabbed him, did what we did, we somehow managed to shift it. But the thing that sticks with me more than anything is what Phil said. And what he said was, don't you dare die on me, Daniel. Something I whispered to him every time I left him after visiting at the hospital. That's why it sticks in my memory. I asked him not to leave us. He couldn't do anything about that, unfortunately. One of the other memories I have of Phil is his love of Man United, obviously. Like the rest of us, we all love Man U. We've shed lots of tears, different times. Joyous. 99 was probably the one when we won the treble. We was all at our house watching it, all of us. And when Solskjaer scored that winner, the roof came off the house, honest to God. And there was so much happiness that night. Other times, not so happy. Sorrow times. He was down at our house again with Liz. Not last season, the season before, when Man City pipped us to the trophy. And we had tears then as well. That was sorrow that time. Phil was very proud. He loved his home, especially his decorating, his woodworking skills. He was particularly proud of a radiator cover that he only just managed to finish around Christmas time. And I know he was particularly proud of that. When the causes of Phil's passing were confirmed, obviously we all felt a lot of emotion. I felt a lot of anger, pain, sorrow, and several other emotions. But they soon changed to immense pride. The reason being, I believe Phil knew exactly how ill he was. And I also believe Phil realised that the probable outcome, what that outcome was likely to be. Knowing this, how Phil conducted himself over the last few months of his life, I believe was absolutely incredible and a credit to him. Daniel, Luke, if you don't remember anything else about today, you remember that, okay? How your dad carried himself the last few months, yeah? You'll be proud of him. Growing up over the years, I've had many heroes in my life, and they've mainly been sporting. Starting with Bobby Charlton, George Best, Brian Robson, Roy Keane, Eric Cantona, then there was Ian Botham, and Jimmy White. I've got a new hero to put at the top of that list now, and that will never change. Lots of words can describe Phil. I've chosen just three. Strength, courage, and heroic. And to me, that sums up Phil. Thank you. Phil.
I'm just going to have a few moments of quiet. And as you sit in the silence, just allow yourself to remember Phil, the things that particularly stand out in your own memory of him. And then we shall gather these into a prayer. So we pray. Merciful Father, hear our prayers and comfort us. Renew our trust in your Son, whom you raised from the dead. Strengthen our faith that all who have died in the love of Christ will share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to sing now the first of two hymns that the family have chosen for this service. You'll find the words on the inside, the left-hand inside page of your service sheets. If you haven't got sight of a service sheet, then hopefully you've got sight of an orange hymn book. If you're using the orange hymn book, then you'll find the words at number 520. So it's 520 in the orange hymn books. Otherwise, you'll find the words on the service sheets. We stand to sing.
Oh,
be seated. Thank you. And to read a passage from Scripture from one of the Gospels, the Gospel of St. Mark. And it's an incident that happened to Jesus and some of his friends. That evening, when evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side of the lake." So leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" Jesus got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." And the wind died down and it was completely calm. Jesus said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Here's a story about Jesus and some friends in a boat at sea when a storm blows up. A sudden storm from seemingly nowhere, and the boats are tossed about on the waves. And I have to wonder if maybe some of you here today are feeling a little as though a sudden storm has come upon you, and that you too are being tossed about on a sea of emotions and feelings. Because as Philip's brother has said, the death of someone we love, whether sudden or half expected, leaves us swamped like the boat in the story, a whole host of emotions. There are very often feelings of regret for things that have either been said or done or not said. There can be questions and a sense of bewilderment and even anger as to why this has happened. And then, of course, there are the more obvious ones of emptiness and sadness when we least expect it at a familiar word or song or action. Sometimes our feelings confuse us because although we are sad that the person is gone, we find ourselves enjoying other things. And we maybe feel that we ought not to be doing so. Grief can be a lot like this and more at times. One minute we're okay, and the next we are not. And for such times as these, we have this story that I've just read. Because just as Jesus was in the boat with his friends, so he is here today for us all. He is travelling alongside us as we are tossed about by the world in which we find ourselves. And just as his friends called out to Jesus, "We're in a mess here," so too can we. And because he cares about us and the way we feel, the emotions that go hand in hand with losing someone we love and admire very much, Jesus will respond, giving us strength and courage when our own fails, and saying those same words to our own anxieties, "Quiet, be still." This is, I realise, for many of you, a difficult journey. Life is not the same as it was, and it will take a long time to adjust. But Jesus longs to give us peace, comfort, and reassurance. It's why he came to earth, to show God's mercy, grace, and love. Through his death and resurrection, Jesus won for us a place in God's kingdom of peace and justice. And it is within this promise that we come today to commend Phil into his keeping. So let us pray for Phil, for his family and his friends. God of mercy, Lord of life, you have made us in your image to reflect your truth and light. We give you thanks for Phil, for the grace and mercy he received from you, for all that was good in his life, and the many memories we treasure today. You promised eternal life to those who believe. Remember for good this, your servant Phil, as we also remember him. Bring all who rest in Christ into the fullness of your kingdom, where sins have been forgiven and death is no more. Your mighty power brings joy out of grief and life out of death. Look in mercy on those who mourn Phil's death, especially Liz, Daniel, Luke and Gillian, Martin and Steph, Wendy and Bob, Paul and Joanne, Sarah and Dave, Joe and Janet, Phil, Jade and William, together with all their families. Surround them with your love and give them faith and courage in times of darkness and strength to face the days to come. You are tender towards your children and your mercy is over all your works. Heal any memories of hurt and failure. Give us the wisdom and grace to use aright the time that is left to us here on earth, to turn to Christ and follow in his steps in the way that leads to everlasting life. God of mercy, entrusting into your hands all that you have made and rejoicing in our communion with all your faithful people, we make our prayers through Jesus Christ our Saviour as we say together the prayer that he taught us. The words are on the service sheet. So we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We stand to sing our second hymn. Words are on the service sheet, or if you're using the orange hymn books, it's number 305. I danced in the morning when the world was begun.
Down from heaven and down.
However, the service will take place at Kings Norton Cemetery, and you're all very welcome to follow the family as we leave church and make our way to the cemetery. But first, would you please remain standing for the prayers of commendation? Let us commend Phil to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Heavenly Father, your Son, Jesus Christ, is the firstborn from the dead. We believe that he will raise up the bodies of his faithful people to be like his in glory. We commend Phil to your mercy and pray that as you gather him to yourself, you will give to us your blessing of peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who died and rose again to save us and is now alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit in glory forever. Amen. Phillip, go forth from this world. The love of God, the Father who created you, the mercy of Jesus Christ, who redeemed you, in the power of the Holy Spirit, who strengthens you. May the heavenly host sustain you and the company of heaven enfold you. In communion with all the faithful, may you dwell this day in peace. Amen. So we pray. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ,
You have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. I've entrusted Phil to God's mercy, and we now commit his body to the ground. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our frail bodies, that they may be conformed to his glorious body, who died, was buried, and rose again for us. To him be glory forever. Amen.
Watch yourself.
Support us, O Lord, all the day long of this troublous life, until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging, a holy rest and peace at the last. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. God give you his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and the next. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you all, now and always. Amen.
Of course.
Actually, if you go...
She's seen enough of me over the years, she don't need to see me anymore. What did you do, tricks?
No, you're calling Jack Ford, what's in his course down to?
Because we never had a bathtub
for that time.
Don't start that one already.
I thought I was so.
Martin, you're 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 Hello.
I'm going to go to the hospital.